Hello, I'm Art Linkletter, your host interviewer, in a series of historical studies produced jointly by the Emeriti Center and the History Media Institute at the University of Southern California. I'm your guest host interviewer because your regular host is our special guest today, Dr. James A. Peterson, the director of the Emeriti Center and professor of sociology and so many other things that if I listed them there wouldn't be time to interview him, is going to add his memories and his presence to this series as we welcome him. And welcoming him is something that I'm used to doing because I did it for 25 years on a house party program over CBS Coast to Coast. And Jim, it's like old times.
It is, Art. Those were some of the happiest and I think most productive hours of my life. However, I'm not sure they were that successful, you know.
Well, of course, while you were talking about marriage and happiness and togetherness, what was happening in the United States?
Well, as soon as I started talking, the divorce rate started to go up, and for 25 years it continued.
I think it had nothing to do with you, but it certainly was representative of a revolutionary change in the social structure of our country. The acceptance of divorce, the acknowledgement that our family structure would never be the same as it had been in the past and never will be again. And we were fighting it, we were accommodating it, and you were researching it.
Right. And we were beginning great programs here at the university. The university saw what was happening and said we must do something about that.
Now, since this series is about the university and the people who make it up and make it go, the students and the teachers, your tenure here goes back into the 40s.
I came first 1945.
And of course you already had a degree then, which was the equivalent of a master's, and you came here for your doctor's.
Right.
Where'd you gone before that?
Well, I took my AB at Ripon College in Wisconsin, and then I spent 4 years at the University of Chicago to get my Bachelor of Divinity degree. So I came as a minister.
I never can accommodate myself to the realization that you, underneath all of your professorial gowns, are a preacher.
Well, you should.
You've been a preacher all your life. You married my son and his wife.
Yes, right.
A very successful marriage now. It's been going on for about 30 years.
Yeah.
But that divinity part of your life came out of your family, your Midwest bringing up?
Well, my father was a minister.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Which church?
Congregational.
And you still do some preaching, don't you?
Yes.
Well, it fit everything else that you became, which was a sociologist, a marriage counselor, a television and radio personality, an author, and an entrepreneur, because I think the tradition of USC professorial people have been that you have been more than teachers. You've gone out and built your departments. Tell us about that.
Well, when I came to be the chairman of the department in the 60s, sociology was going through a revolution. Sociology used to be speculative, philosophical, but about that time it became in the forefront a scientific endeavor to learn truth. And what I had to do was find people who knew statistics and research and bring them here and then move forward in the direction of giving up the old and starting the new. And that wasn't easy. Some of our older professors didn't like that switch, but we made it.
And of course it took money, and you not only had to figure out what you wanted to do but how to pay for it.
That we had. SC was relatively poor through almost all of its history until the last few years when we're doing better. But we interviewed T. McClare, who was our oldest professor on campus a couple of months ago, and she died. She told us she came to campus, she was paid $1,000 a year. She had to raise two children, take care of a sick husband, and teach. But Dr. Rufus von Kleinschmidt, who was then the president, later chancellor, had rough going. So the next year he had to cut all the salaries 20%, and for 2 years she got $800 a year.
Mm-hmm. People forget that when they look at the gigantic campus and the tremendous accomplishments of USC today. When you came, which was long after she arrived here, there were not that many buildings, were there?
seven or eight main buildings, but there were a great many buildings, army barracks. We taught in these huge places where the soldiers had lived. And that was very interesting because the partitions were very thin. And I would have 100, 150 students here, and there'd be 50 or so next door. And he couldn't hear because I was lecturing, and I couldn't hear, so the crescendo
rose, like a cocktail party
exactly.
conversation.
And by the end of the hour, we were pretty hoarse.
And when you established the marriage counseling department here, you were in almost a shed, weren't you?
Well, I must admit, it was a dump.
That's the inelegant way to say
well,
shed.
It was an old cottage. And we have worked under some difficulties there, Art, because it had one heater in the middle of the floor. It was down underneath. But the radiators from both sides came up, the vents, into that room and this room. And those were our counseling rooms. So it was often fairly embarrassing when I was talking about sexual matters, for instance, to a couple, and suddenly it'd be silent on the other side, and we knew that the other couple found it more entertaining to listen to us than to work on their own problems. Or the same thing happened when I had clients there. But we got along. We made it, you know. Uh-huh. That's what's important.
I had somewhat the same experiences through my life of traveling and personal appearances when I've stayed in cheap hotels. Many times the things that were going on through the wall was more interesting than anything I was thinking of.
Yes, exactly.
Speaking of that, Jim, we're going to jump around here today. It is startling to me, and I wonder how you think, of the way that the expression of intimate personal relationships, which are involved in family counseling and therapy, have changed in the emergence of a Ruth Westheimer.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I hear her on the TV saying words and advising things that you would scarcely have said in the privacy of a room to two people.
Right.
When you were first in this work.
But you remember, due to my appearance on House Party, I then achieved my own show, For Better or For Worse, in which we looked at couples. And the university promoted this for me and wrote the contract. And I'll always be grateful because in the contract they said I had control of the script. Because it was a scientific show. And I would talk about the uterus or about the vagina or what. And a vice president from CBS would fly out, script in hand. We'd meet 7 o'clock in the morning, and for 2 hours he'd say, Dr. Peterson, do you have to use those words? He was offended. And I finally said, yes, it's a scientific show, and the public needs to be able to talk in dignified and awkward ways. So I'm going to use it. Well, he said, Dr. Peterson, please, use it only once.
Of course, when I began in radio in 1933 in San Diego, we had a memo one time came through after I'd read a newscast bulletin, never, ever, ever to use the word pregnant.
Yes.
It was a no-no.
Yes.
So how far we've come from there till today, we're describing orgasmic experiences and masturbation. Mm-hmm. Everything is talked about, and it probably is not bad.
It probably is wonderful. I'll tell you why. Because it enables us to look at sex as wholesome, and we don't have to sweep it under the carpet. And we can, as we did here on campus at the university, talk with thousands, literally, of young people and give them standards that are based on knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Now, of course, your life is so full of so many developmental stages. First, about 1950 or so, you became the head of the Department of Sociology.
Yes.
Was it much of a department?
We had, I think, at that time, 7 members in the department. And
how big is it now?
It's about 16 now. Mm-hmm. We made it grow. But it grew in other ways. The University of Southern California is fairly unique, I think, because what it does is look out in the community and see what are the needs, and then we try to meet it. We have literally been a community university in that sense. For instance, Dr. Topping came, he found that very little being done for the great financial center we're developing downtown. And so he developed a business administration that has literally undergirded Los Angeles. And our current president is looking, he sees the Pacific Rim. And that tomorrow, our great interactions, trade and every other way, are going to be out there. So now our emphasis is going to be on courses and insight. Well, when I came in the university, partly through my prodding, saw the need for marriage counseling and marriage education, they gave full backing to that and became a very dynamic program here at the university. In sociology, we looked around, the streets were full of gangs, no one doing anything about it, and we developed one of the great youth studies in the whole world, and that still is here. So that sociology began to move out. We have a demography department, we have a gerontological department, all in sociology. So I'm very happy. We have one of the great sociology departments now in the country.
Well, it's interesting, as you've grown older, you have moved from marriage counseling of the young people and career counseling to gerontology, which is becoming, as the graying of America progresses, more and more important, just as the Pacific Rim is economically,
exactly,
and changing that course of the university, you have nudged the sociology department into examining the older people.
That's right.
And when you and I appeared together in Florida about a year ago at the School of Gerontology, I was astounded to learn that, pioneered by USC, the study of gerontology has spread to thousands of colleges where it was only 10 or 12 when you began, or in that era. It's a need.
We are not only studying, but we have, of course, over in the Andrus Gerontology Center, the most comprehensive, the largest, and I think the most profound study of aging in the whole world. But more than that, we have another department which we're training people how to work with bolsters, the service angle, so that otherwise we stumbled. We didn't know much about this 25, 30 years ago. Now we've developed enough research so we know what to do for different kinds of problems that older people have. And of course, that was part of the thing that I did. I had three major studies funded by the National Institute of Health on housing the aged. And we looked into such things as Leisure World and Sun City. And I think you had one of those that I visited a couple of times down near Palm Springs, wasn't it?
Yes, near Kansas City, too.
That's right, exactly, exactly. Well, I firmly believe that for young people, if they want a dynamic field that is opening up and it gives you a sense of helping, gerontology is that field.
Another thing that you've been very active in that people should be reminded of is the continuing use of older people who, in the faculty for instance, are retired and are no longer just pushed aside or put on the shelf, but you have prodded the university and others into using them as part-time counselors, as part-time researchers, part-time teachers, which has been good for both the retiree and the university. Would you like to tell us how you feel about that?
Well, as director of the Emeriti Center, I did a major study 6 years ago to discover what was happening to our retired professors. And I must say, about half of them were unhappy. Their lives weren't going anywhere. One thing that happened, they were amputated from the university. They had no communication, and they felt very badly about that, and we've done a good deal about that. We have a newsletter that keeps them in touch with us. But then I saw that many of them wanted to go on and do part-time work. Last year we had six over in our student counseling center. They know the campus, they know the ropes, they have the time. As Mark Hobson said, you know, university sitting on the end of the log and the student on the other end, and that's what these six did as counselors. We have 100 volunteers at the Gerontology Center. They do a research with us, they go out and interview for me in my studies. Just remarkable. And they stand straighter because they're doing something worthwhile, Art.
Well, you and I are pretty good examples of that. We're in our middle 70s almost, and we're both busy, involved, people taking chances, being curious, looking ahead.
Right.
And I think it makes us healthier, mentally and physically, to feel involved?
We haven't many parameters, things we're certain of in aging, but one thing we are, and that is that if we keep active mentally, our brain will grow. If we keep active physically, our cells will remain healthy. You use it or you lose it, Art, in many ways.
I sometimes say you can't stop the hardening of the arteries, perhaps, but you can stop the hardening of the attitudes.
Yes, exactly.
An attitude is a lot.
Yep.
We've been talking about you now and the sort of Renaissance man kind of life you've lived with all of these things, writing, filming, lecturing, business, and the rest. I think we ought to bring in one of your old students and let me see what he thinks about you and how he sees you.
That'll be a good corrective.
So Dr. Ray Fowler, will you come in, please? Any portrait of a professor would be incomplete without a look at him through the eyes of one of his students. And Dr. Ray Fowler has agreed to come before our cameras today and tell us something about his association with Dr. Peterson. When did you first know Jim?
Well, Art, I've known Jim since I was in junior high school, because the church that I belong to as a young person is in the same denomination as Jim's background, and he was minister of the Manhattan Beach Congregational Church when I was in Long Beach, and we used to get together our youth fellowships for inter-church meetings. So I've known him for a good many years. That was back in the 40s.
Was he a firebrand preacher, a philosophical, benign kind of a preacher? How would you characterize him as a minister?
I would say that Jim's great strength was that he was very, very interesting and exciting and always very solid in what he had to offer the young people and the adults.
Because you see, I saw him once as a minister under entirely different circumstances. I was in New York City making a personal appearance on What's My Line, and I flew all the way to Hollywood for one day to appear at a wedding Jim was presiding over, and I was to be a part of the wedding, and he forgot me. So I went out and got on an airplane and flew back to New York. He forgot me. I was supposed to give the bride away. So did you ever see those kind of lapses when you were part of his congregation?
Well, I didn't see any lapses like that.
I have never seen one like that in my life, and it remains a constant kidding topic between us. Why did you become a student of his at USC?
Well, I had for years been planning to go into the ministry, and I did. And when I had finished my ministerial training in Berkeley, I came back to Southern California. And one of the first things that I was responsible for doing was conducting weddings of young people at the university where I was teaching. I was on the church staff at a university-oriented congregation, and the young people came to me and asked me to do their weddings. And I realized that I had been all through college, I was myself married, I had been all through seminary, and I didn't know a thing about marriage. And that was a very scary experience.
Launching young people out into the life when you didn't have anything to tell them.
Here's a couple standing before me, and I'm giving the authority of the church and the blessing of the church to them, and yet I don't know anything that's really important to tell them about getting along in marriage together. And so at that point, I heard about my old friend Jim Peterson being here at USC, and I thought, he's got to know a lot about it, and I better find out as much as I can. So in 1955, in February of 1955, second semester of that academic year, I came to USC and started taking courses one at a time, because I was working in the full-time ministry out in the eastern part of Los Angeles County. And so I would drive all the way into the campus one night a week and take a course and drive back, and course by course I began to work on a doctorate here at USC in the sociology department with the new program that Jim had established in marriage counseling.
How long did it take you to complete that program?
Well, I'd prefer not to tell you how many years it was until I finally got my degree, but it was a long time, because except for 2 years when I went full-time K-12 came back full-time as a student. I did it one or two courses at a time, sometimes three courses in the summer session when I had a little lighter load in my church.
I wouldn't feel embarrassed about that. I had a friend once who spent 3 years in the fourth grade. But it did take you a lot of years to get through it. Was he a hard teacher? Was he demanding? Was he a person?
Well, Jim has been a very demanding teacher all his career, but demanding in a way that was very supportive, not harsh, but the kind of teacher who would push you to the utmost and support you all the way in that. I remember one of the things that I became involved in fairly early in my campus time was as one of his teaching assistants in this magnificent course of his, Education for Marriage, which he eventually wrote a basic text for, which is still widely used. In that course, a lot of undergraduate students would attend the large lectures, and we had the whole auditorium in Bovard full for the large lectures, which Jim usually did. And then we would break up into small discussion groups, and that was very unusual in those days as a way of handling an academic course.
It was a popular course.
It was a very popular course. And sometimes students would sign up for the course thinking that it was Education for Marriage, it'd be a snap course.
Sounds like it.
But after the first test, there were a lot of students who dropped out because they had been looking for an easy credit and they weren't going to get it, they realized, in that course. So Jim was always very demanding, even at the undergraduate level.
I'm going to bring you back into our focus, Jim, and ask you to rebut a little of this by saying what kind of a student he was in your memory.
I had the most remarkable group that came in about 1955, the first group that got into this marriage counseling training program. I had MDs, I had ministers. They were all extraordinarily bright, and I was rough on them, I'll admit it, because I wanted them to have a good background. I made them take a pre-medical scientific series of courses, embryology. I would never do that to another student. They took 5 or 6 years to get through that first bunch.
Uh-huh.
They have all made very great distinctive contributions, so it was all right. Well, I'm not going to rebut what he said. I think good teaching is teaching that edges the student into truth and that moves him farther along. And to do that, they have to study. They must sit in the library and they must sit in the laboratory and then they must think. So that I agree, I've not been the easiest teacher.
While you were teaching him, or while you were teaching at this particular time, weren't you also the president of the American Association of Marriage Counselors?
Yes, and Ray can tell us about that.
Yes, Art, one of the things that Jim always emphasized in his program was not only the academic involvement and hard academic labor, but also laboring out in the vineyard, if you will, in the marketplace, in real life, because this was a practical course as well as being a very demanding academic course. And of course, Jim set the standard in terms of his own modeling of that sort of thing with his work in marriage counseling in the community here in Los Angeles, the Peterson Goodell Center, which was founded. And over the years, he distinguished himself as a leader in the profession of marriage counseling and became a very active member of the American Association of Marriage Counselors, which had been founded in the late 30s. It had a very small, very elite membership nationwide, and Jim was the most distinguished member of that, probably west of Chicago. And consequently, eventually he became president of the association. They elected him president at a very tough time in the history of that organization in 1968. And I'd be happy to tell you about those exciting days.
Of course, it was a very difficult thing to organize, as I recall, because what constituted a marriage counselor? What, a man could write his name on a shingle, hang it outside of his office, say, I'm a marriage counselor. Who's to say He wasn't. Because anybody can counsel on marriage.
Yeah.
People ask me, what is the secret of your success of being married 50 years to the same woman? And I often say to them, it's three little words. And they say, I love you. And I said, no, community property law. You can get all kinds of advice, some kidding, mm-hmm, sure, some cynical. So to organize and make this a legitimate, definable, reasonable thing was a problem, wasn't it?
But we did that, Art. We began with our own state legislature and passed a licensing law. It's now spread to all but 10 states have those. Our national organization did that. We took a chance that year. It was their 25th year, and as Ray said, we weren't going anywhere. So we took all the money we had in endowment, $57,000, and said we'll use it for expenses. We got a full-time executive secretary, Ed Ridman, who's a friend of mine from Dallas, and he served magnificently, and we began to grow. And just the time that money ran out, the dues began to support us. And then Ray was the next. I had nominated him to follow Ridman, and for what, 6 years, 8 years?
10 years.
10 years. He ran in magnificent fashion. And how many members do we have now?
About 10,000.
Of the American Association of Marriage
and Family.
Right. Yeah. Well, it's changed its name a couple of times, and it's now the American Association for Marriage and Family Therapy.
Better.
But it's the organization
wider
that
spread.
Began,
mm-hmm,
right, in the 30s.
So that's what you're doing in your professional life?
Until 1982. From 1972 until 1982, I was the executive director of that organization. When I took the position, as Jim says, after a previous executive director had gone through this very scary but magnificently adventuresome period of using their total endowment, their complete resources in a full push drive to get enough members that they could survive on the basis of membership income,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
then at the time that I took over, they had 1,200 members nationwide in Canada, and they had an annual membership dues income of just a little under $60,000 a year. And the momentum had been started with Jim's impetus as president, and so that kept growing, and new states kept licensing the profession. And by the time the offices were moved to Washington, D.C. in 1982, and I left the position, or rather the association left the West Coast and moved to Washington, we had about 9,000 members, and we had just completed our first $1 million-plus budget year. So
Jim, must make you feel very proud, and I'm sure all the USC professors who've been here for the last 40 years can look at students like Dr. Ray Fowler in their own studies and feel that that is the continuation, that's the immortality,
right,
of a teacher.
Mm-hmm. I think that, not to put it out of perspective, but I think at USC, because we have had through the years some very distinguished men like Frank Baxter that you knew, Floyd Rue, Dr. Emery Bogardus, started sociology in the whole West Coast, and more later. But because we had that kind of men, and because their great focus was on the student has been central here, and we do try to have very intimate relationships with them, let them come with their problems, and help them when they get stuck. It's been rewarding to me, of course, obviously, to have such men as Dr. Fowler get their start in my program.
To jump a little farther ahead at the moment, Jim, I wanted to ask you about this special organization you made for older people, the Rossmore Institute for the Study of Retirement and Aging. I hadn't heard about that. What is that?
Well, that was very short-lived. Dr. Topping called me into the office one day and asked me whether I'd form and head up a committee to see whether we should study aging on campus. He had a possibility of getting $1 million, and I did form such a committee, and we began study. In fact, the first study of aging was done. Now, we called it Rossmore Cortese Institute because he gave us the first money to
Leisure
start
World.
Leisure World. and we were down at Leisure World working with them and studying them. Well, after a while, it became apparent that that source of funds was going to dry up. Leisure World didn't do well for quite a while. And if we were going to continue, we would have to find some other funding. And we related ourselves to the American Association of Marriage, American Association of Retired Persons, now have 20 million members, and they built our building for us and so forth, and we changed our name. The best thing I did as the first director of the Rossmore Cortese Institute was to bring Dr. Jim Bieran to campus. He's been a magnificent director of the gerontological enterprise and is retiring this year.
But what a wonderful progression you've had an opportunity to ride through your 45 years here from the very first time until now, when you're just as busy as you've ever been. Mm-hmm. I've never believed in a fountain of youth. Nobody ever found one. But you apparently have found the fountain of age.
Well, part of it is because, and you demonstrate this yourself, part of it is because of the diversity of my life. I brought along just a couple of my books to show you. You've read them. This one on widows and widowhood has helped a great many people. And when people read it, they said, I wish you'd do a film. So last year, we wrote a film and produced it. It's called Grieving Suddenly Alone. It won first place at the American Film Festival.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
A producer.
Yeah, yes. And this is the book that Ray was talking about. This is the 25th anniversary book, which I edited. And the interesting thing is that I have a chapter in this book that I wrote on, is marriage counseling a profession? We weren't sure 25 years ago. This book, Married Love in the Middle Years, bought me a house, but it did a great deal of good. It was published in the Netherlands. This is the Netherlands edition.
Oh, yes. Who wish lives not in Vietnam.
Yeah, and
I never
read
it.
You didn't.
No.
You should when you get to middle age.
I will.
And this also is published in French, so that that has been a very productive book. The other book I'll show you is the one that Ray talked about, Marriage Education for Marriage. And that's significant not because it was used, still is used in hundreds of colleges and universities, but it's significant because it introduced a new dimension, and that is the psychological dimension. Other textbooks before, as I remember, talked about mixed marriage and things like that. But in this book, and this is the book that your son and both your daughters used in courses with me, we got into their heart, and we got into their attitudes, and we began to affect them in ways that really would make some contribution to life.
And so we have looked very briefly, and I think very interestingly, into the heart and the mind and the life of Dr. James A. Peterson, director of the Emeriti Center and professor of sociology, a man who represents the University of Southern California in its finest flower. Thank you, Jim.
Thank you, Art. Thank you, Ray.